given. So, we have a scalar potential that is zero everywhere, and we have a vector potential with a weird form that has to be not k over 4 c. Temperature for its system to T 0 elements. So the question now is, what are the charge and current distributions that would give you this kind of potentials? And as we've already said, the direct relations between potentials and current distributions, they're typically quite messy, typically very difficult to evaluate directly. So that what one usually does is actually calculate the fields first and then use Maxwell's equations to relate to charges and currents. So let's first figure out what the electric fields and magnetic fields are here. So we calculate electric fields. We just divide that, and we calculate the fields from the potentials minus gradient V. Again, this is one of the things when we wake you up at 3 o'clock in the morning, you have to remember. VA over VT. So that is our gradient V. If V is 0, then the gradient is 0, obviously. What is the A over VT? It gives us a 2 and a factor C out, and there's only one of the parentheses. Right? So it gives you mu naught K over 2 CT minus absolute value of x and goes to this direction. Right? So if we, as a function of x here, we can set the points where these become zero. And so this is x equals minus ct, x equals plus ct, right? You can see wherever this is non-zero, that expands out with the speed of light. And so for t equals 0, there's nothing there at all. As time goes on, we have a larger and larger region of space. We have a potential, and we also have fields there, right? So the electric field then goes positive, goes to 0 here, goes essentially up at the end of the region. So we have an electric field that goes up here, goes to the maximum level. So the maximum, this is the y component, so the z component of the electric field. And the maximum value for x equals 0 is just ct. So this is mu naught. Right? Okay. Magnetic field we calculate as curl of A. So now, let's write it out again just to make sure we do it right. components. Well, the thing is, we only have a Z component for A, right? Yes?
Same plus minus comes back out, so it's always
the same, so we have just the minus sign now, so it's mu naught k over 2c, right? And that should be equal to mu naught j plus mu naught epsilon naught d over dt. Okay. Now the e over dt, the time derivative of this, gives us, again, so this is mu naught j plus mu naught epsilon naught. And here we have dt, just give it a factor c out. So mu naught k over 2c. And this is now we know that mu naught epsilon naught is 1 over c squared. So mu naught epsilon naught gives us 1 over c squared. And now we have this term being exactly equal to this term. So that means j must also be 0. Now that looks weird, doesn't it? Can that be all? Can it be possible that we have no currents, no charges, but we have, at least in this part of space, non-zero fields and non-zero potentials? Can we have fields and potentials with no currents and no charges? So there must be something weird. What's weird? What have we done wrong? Or what have I done wrong? I've taken derivatives there, right? What's the thing with derivatives? When can you calculate a derivative? What kind of function do you need for a derivative? Look at a function like this here, that went here, goes here, and then suddenly jumps up here and continues up there. Can we take its derivative of this function? Cannot. We can do that everywhere, but not here, right? So this is true everywhere, except for x equals 0. Right? With x equals 0, we have to think about something else. So what we have here is that we have a b component that we continue over here now. Suddenly, say you have piece of metal or so, and then the fields go this way. On top, they go the opposite direction. Anybody remember what that means for this sheet here? For this, what is happening in this sheet at x equals 0? So, see the magnetic field goes in the y direction here. So we have a z direction in the plane here as well. You must have seen that as well for magnetostatics. There must be a current somewhere here in this sheet, right? Otherwise, you don't get magnetic fields. Must be a current somewhere. So, let's say, we have a current going here, say, in that direction. Let's call that current density K. Alright, to calculate, does anybody remember how that relates to the fields? How the current relates to the field? The current sheet. So what it does, we can do a little trick. Assume we have, we look at a little, you know, wire or something that has some length h, some length l, and we just integrate over this area. It's a, I'm sorry, a is h times l, right? Let's integrate Maxwell's equation over that area. So, we do that. Let's calculate integral over this area. Curl of B. A. So, we have this area element as a vector. In what direction is that vector pointing then? To integrate, we do an area integral. In what direction is this vector differential area pointing? Plane this. The vector is pointing in what direction? Perpendicular to the plane, right? So more to it. So this goes essentially in the z direction. That would be mu naught integral j. A and plus mu naught at mu naught over t. Okay, now we can do a trick here. That's one of Gauss's laws. The curl integrated over an area between the place y. Have seen that in math classes or earlier electrodynamics classes. Integral over the area of a curl, we can replace y, so area A by integral over the boundary of A times what do you integrate over the boundary then? You just do the line integral over the boundary of B is the same as the curl over the area. You seen that in math classes? You must have seen that. Okay, what is this? Now we know we have B only in the y direction. So we actually, so let's call this here, let's call this 1, call this 2. Then this is actually just the length over which we're integrating plus v1 minus v2, right? There's no contribution from this. Okay, this is now mu naught and j dA. Let's say this current density is always the same. goes in the direction of A, right? So the dot product is just 1. So this is the current density K, of course, is just J times the height. This is current per area, this is current per volume, right? So times the height gives you just the current density, yeah? So this is the current density K times L plus something from this term that also has the area in it. What we do, of course, in the end, is take this height to 0. You always have a finite term here. You have a finite term here because the magnetic fields have different values, top and bottom. Whereas here, essentially, you just have this volume that shrinks to 0. So this term will drop out. So that means the L's drop out. So B1 minus 2 is just mu naught. If you look at that in terms of vectors, this of course goes in the y direction, k goes in the z direction. So what we have here is actually the x direction cross. So we get b2, b1 minus b2. The y direction is mu naught across this. Okay, that was the long way just to calculate what is this current density. So we know the current density goes in the k direction. So current density k goes in the z direction as we have here, and it's minus the difference here, so this plus minus over mu root. So this is just, let me get the signs right here. Just simply okay, this, let me just as a bit of a refresher of what you have probably seen here. So we have no currents, no charges anywhere except at this boundary of x equals 0, and there the current density, the surface current density, gives you magnetic fields of opposite directions. Okay, does that all make sense? Okay, maybe we can. I don't think it makes sense to introduce the Green's function now in 10 minutes. That will probably not come across. So I think we'll start up with that next week, and also next week. That's essentially all we do next week. So what we'll do next week is start out with our orange page expression for the potentials. So that was essentially the main result of today, that we had these Faraday operators A equals minus mu naught J, and the Faraday operator of B being minus rho over epsilon naught. And we will derive how we can actually calculate A and B of R just from a solution to this equation. We have any kind of arbitrary distribution of charges and currents. We'll derive next week how we can use those charges and currents to calculate what these potentials are. But that will make sense. Any questions? None? Okay, as I said, Michael should be back today. He will contact you by email and set up for the tutorial sessions. So by then you have more questions, of course, you'll be having your heart. Most likely you'll stay with that for one state or just stable two. Bill of action. And for the problems, please do one Friday.